BookTube, it's Angie. Working with a little bit of different lighting here. My husband was watching some of my videos at work and he said, "You mentioned something about the lighting being too yellow in your videos." And I think we were at Walmart, maybe? I think it was Walmart we were at the other day. And he found these, they're kind of like Edison looking bulbs at Walmart that fit the lighting fixture we have up here, and instead of putting off like the harsh white light, which tended to give me headaches anyway because I have a light sensitivity, he found these lighter ones. I keep looking up like you can see them. He found these lighter ones that have kind of like an amber glow on them, which makes it a lot softer in here. I notice I don't have headaches or eye strain as much anymore. If you hear like grunting noises, the little dog is underneath the tripod here. But I'm trying it out. I don't know if it's coming off all right. I guess I'll have to see in editing. Today I wanted to talk about the first of the Houdini videos. I kept talking about the Houdini videos I wanted to do. This is going to be the first of those. This is going to be the nonfiction round. There's going to be two books today. I have a few other fiction books that are inspired by Houdini's life. Harry Houdini, the magician. I think the way I'm going to do those is break those down into two videos, because one video is going to be a duology set of books. So that will probably be video three. But let's start with the nonfiction. The book that started this whole idea for me was months back. I'm sure you guys remember this. I don't remember exactly when I got this. It was a while ago though. But months back, I was sent this book for review. The Witch of Lime Street by David Jaher, I think it is. I'm not quite sure. But this is a nonfiction book about, and just in case anybody's wondering, I've already read and reviewed, submitted my review and everything. That's already been taken care of. I'm just going back and doing a video for you guys about it, about all the information I covered in this book, or read about, I guess. I covered, like I wrote it, all the information that was covered in this book, I guess I should say. So this looks at the period of spiritualism that took off right after World War I. I think it started prior to that. The whole movement really gathered steam right after World War I, because a lot of people got interested in it after losing so many family members in the war, or during that time period, not necessarily in the war, but just in that time period. There was also a influenza outbreak, I think, around that time that took a lot of people at the same time while World War I was going on. So you had people losing family members pretty much simultaneously between World War I and the influenza outbreak sometimes during that time span. So it was just like a big hit for the human population in general during those years. Spiritualism really took off. For the people who followed it, they honestly considered it a religion. It wasn't just an idea or a movement. They considered it a religion on par with Christianity or Buddhism or anything like that. And if you're not familiar with the idea of spiritualism, it's more in-depth than what I'm about to say, but in just like Sparks Notes terms, it's basically the belief and the study of the afterlife and what goes on in the afterlife and communicating with people after they've passed and all of that. That's the idea, is that drive to connect with the people you've lost is the big push with spiritualism. So this book looks at that period, and where Houdini comes into this was he started out having I don't know if it's like a concrete belief, but he had a curiosity about the afterworld when he was younger. And one of the things that spurred him to look into the movement was when he was I forget his age, but I want to say he was still in his childhood, maybe teen years, maybe a little bit earlier. He lost his father to tongue cancer, and his mother was just shattered with the death. And to try to comfort her, Houdini took his mother to a local psychic or spiritual medium, whatever you want to call it, try to see if they could contact his father and maybe give his mom some peace. Well, it didn't go very well because he was sitting there completely open-minded, hope for the best, but from what I gather, from what I've read from different things, it seems that whatever the medium said to him in that sitting, said to his mother, to him it sounded very canned, very formulaic. It didn't sound personalized to who his father was, but his mom was in that space where she was kind of grasping onto anything because she was in that, you know, space of pain. But it really bothered Houdini to feel like there was this person that was taking advantage of his mother's grief. It put a little bit of a sour taste in his mouth for the idea, but he didn't write it off completely, the whole idea of the afterlife. Then years later, when his mother passed, he looked into it again because he's like, well, I would like to try to contact my mother. And again, he had the same experience. He was going to numerous different mediums and he kept getting the same response. They were giving him very canned answers, very bland kind of blanket statements about, oh, she wants you to forgive yourself, she wants you to be at peace, she wants you to love yourself. He wasn't getting anything that sounded specific to his mother and what he knew of her. And it was frustrating him because he always said that he believed in the afterworld, he believed in religion, he believed in God, but it was just this movement, this thing where everyone was running to these mediums and wanting to find answers through them. And everyone he visited kept seeming to have the same response and the same answers and the same sort of script. On top of like spiritual readings, then you get into like spirit knocking, where people were going to seances and people were seeing like spirit plasmas coming out of psychics and things on tables being moved. The term spirit knocking was tied to the actual knocking noises that would be made during seances. A lot of people were like, oh my gosh, it's paranormal. Oh, we've made connection. But Houdini, with his experience with doing magic shows and traveling with carnivals and that kind of thing, he started to see little tricks that he knew performers in his industry used, that the spirit mediums were using. And so what started as skepticism for him turned into a full-on project to start uncovering all these people, because it really ticked him off that the spirit mediums were making money off of the grief of people who had lost loved ones. He said, that's messed up. People are hurting and you're taking their money and living fabulous lives off of money they cannot afford to give up. Because a lot of times it was people that came from backgrounds that honestly didn't have that kind of money to be throwing away. They came from working backgrounds. They, you know, could be farmers or shopkeepers or something like that, but they were just so desperate to talk to their spouses or their lost children or parents or whoever it was, that they would throw away this money. This book, The Witch of Lime Street, looks at one particular case. Well, it looks at a number of cases, but it focuses in on this woman that was known as the Witch of Lime Street. But before you get to that, you learn a lot about the quest, kind of, I guess you would call it, that Harry Houdini went on to uncover all of these different mediums. And the way a lot of this came out was through a contest that Scientific America magazine put out when the spiritualism idea was really taking off. Scientific America picked up on the trend and they were like, you know what, we're going to run a contest to anyone who could come forward and provide measurable proof of the paranormal, something that scientists could actually use instruments on, or anything that could irrefutably be voted as paranormal. Like, they couldn't come up with any other explanation for it. They wanted to see what you had. Harry Houdini happened to be one of the men that was chosen to be on the Scientific America panel, which one of the things that came up in this book that surprised me that I wasn't even aware of was the friendship between Harry Houdini, the magician, and the author, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the creator of Sherlock Holmes. They had a pretty solid friendship before all this went down. I didn't realize that this whole thing ended up causing such a huge rift between them that the friendship kind of imploded. The problem was Harry Houdini, over his lifetime, became a big-ass skeptic of psychic mediums. Not of the afterworld and religion, but just of the psychic mediums, the people who were calling themselves mediums, or anybody who was claiming to have ability to talk to people in the afterworld. It's not that he immediately wrote them off, but he went into every single case very skeptical, but he always had that open of prove me wrong. He always said he wanted to believe, he wanted somebody to show him that this skill existed, but he said every case he came across, he could debunk it or refute it. And I didn't realize there was such a feud that sprung up between Houdini and Doyle, because Doyle was a hardcore spiritualist. And I knew a little bit about Doyle's life from the whole fairy incident where the girls were making the photographs of the fairies, and some people were skeptical about if it was real or not. Doyle bought it 100% and put his support behind it, saying, oh, it was totally real, fairies exist. Funny thing about that story, though, is if you go and Google pictures of the fairies they were talking about, it's kind of funny to look at those photos now, because they look so fake. So fake to us now, at least to me. And then I also read a story recently in some history book where it actually came out that there was a guy that came out later and said that the fairies in those pictures looked identical to a poster image he had in his shop. Like, the kids had maybe gotten a copy of that poster and cut out the fairies from the poster and put them on these little stands or something. I just thought that was kind of funny. Anyway, I knew a little bit about Doyle's life outside of being writer from that whole fiasco, because he took a pretty big hit to his credibility backing that. But I didn't know a lot beyond that story. So when he came up in this, I was really surprised to find out just how deep in the spiritual movement he was. And it was funny because in this book, they talk about how Scientific America, they wanted a really unbiased panel, or at least so they said. And then one of the first people they pick is Harry Houdini. And Doyle got really offended, and he was like, what? You said you wanted unbiased. That's the most unbiased person you could have. Then Houdini was like, what are you talking about, man? I'm gonna hear him out. I'm not gonna immediately write off everybody. But as you read through the book, it gets progressively more and more heated between the two of them. While I'm talking about the panel, I think I have an image I can put up here, or at least I'll try to find it, of all the people that were on that panel. But a couple of the people you might recognize, or at least some of their work. One was Daniel Comstock, who invented the Technicolor process that was used in a lot of movies in like the 40s and 50s, I think. There was also, in this book, they mentioned that while Daniel was working at MIT, he developed a quartz-based UV camera lens that could pick up things that were invisible to the naked eye, which I thought was pretty cool. There was also Harold Carrington, who in this book they said is one of the first people to advocate the practice of yoga and juice diets in the United States. He was also on that panel. While this contest was going on, I thought it was also funny that in the book they mentioned that when Scientific America announced their contest, a General Assembly of Spiritualists countered with their own contest and for the same amount of prize money. And they said that they would award the prize money to feats of faked manifestation. One of the things that cracked me up when I was reading about this, the General Assembly contest from the spiritualist community, is when they said that they would pay money for faked manifestations, Harry Houdini was one of the first ones to come forward and say, I will totally give you fake manifestations. hand over. But then he backed out because he said, well, I'm on the Scientific America panel. That wouldn't be quite right. So I'll back up. But I'm just saying I could do it. I thought that was pretty funny. Where the Witch of Lime Street comes in. The Witch of Lime Street was a nickname the press gave to this woman, Marjorie Crandon. I think that was her name. Mina Crandon. She also went by Marjorie. And she was the wife of a Boston surgeon. She became interested in the spiritualist movement. I think it was said that she started getting messages from her brother who had passed, or she was claiming she was getting messages from her dead brother. So she started holding seances in her dining room or living room or something within her house and became very popular in the area. And she was one of the people that came forth as one of the contestants on Scientific America's contest. And she was one of the top runners in the contest. I don't know if she was the closest, but she came like the top three or something, I think. One of the top tier contestants as far as, for a while anyway, having experiences that the panel was having trouble proving as faked. She caught Harry's curiosity for a while, but then things went down, of course. Once again, he ran into his wall of skepticism. The case with her ended up dividing the panel. There were some people that totally believed what she was doing, and then others that were like, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know if I buy it. But yeah, there's a lot of information covered in this book. It's interesting in parts. Some of the writing can get kind of dry, but as far as the history, it's pretty entertaining when when they're talking about the people that were competing in Scientific America's contest. The descriptions sound a lot like, you know, the early weeks of American Idol competitions, which, you know, a lot of, I don't know about you, but I know myself and a lot of my friends, that's like really the only time we get really invested in that show. I mean, I think it's off now, but when it was on, that was about the only time we got invested were, you know, the people that were just blatantly, yeah, not talented in that department. And some of the descriptions in here of people that were trying to prove that they had paranormal talent. Yeah, that was pretty funny. 'Cause when they talk about the judges' reactions on Scientific America panel, they're like, but one of the things that kept me reading, you know, pushing through the dry parts, I became really interested in the developing feud between Houdini and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, because I didn't really know a lot about that aspect of their friendship. As it turns out, they started off, it was interesting, it was a little bit sad when you think about it in as a whole, because you're, as the reader, you're basically watching this friendship slowly crumble. But it was also kind of interesting to watch that process. 'Cause a lot of us, when we're going through it, we're in it. We're not always on the sidelines witnessing it. And I don't know, it's like, it goes back to that train wreck thing, you know, car wreck thing, or it's like, it's uncomfortable, but your eyes won't let you go, pull away. Even though you want to be like, no, stop, and that's kind of what I felt like reading this friendship slowly crumble, because in the beginning of the book, they had sort of a friendly rivalry. It was sort of like, oh, you believe your thing, I believe mine, but hey, we're still best of buds and everything's great. And then the further along they got in this contest, the more and more they each felt their beliefs challenged by the other friend. There were a lot of things that Houdini was saying that Doyle was taking a lot of offense to. And I think the thing that, you know, that straw that broke the camel's back moment ended up being when things were tense between them, but they all decided to go on this kind of couple's vacation with Houdini and his wife and Doyle and his wife. Doyle's wife claimed that she had the ability to talk to people on the other side. During this vacation, Doyle came out and said, Harry, my wife would like to give you a reading. She says that she's been getting messages that concern you. And once again, Houdini was like, all right, I'll hear you out. And so he sits down with Doyle and Doyle's wife, and she begins her process, which included spirit writing. It's the idea of when a spirit from the other side comes into a person and is able to write a message through the living person, or compel them, maybe mentally or somehow, to write a message for them, because they don't have a physical body. So that's largely where her skill was supposed to be. But she also is supposed to be audibly hearing messages. Harry Houdini sits down with Doyle and his wife, and it ends up being this whole message from Harry's mother, supposedly. Doyle's wife writes out this whole big thing, letter, basically, to Harry. That's supposed to be this big, long message from Harry's mother to him, saying all the things she wanted to say, but she's crunched for time, and she doesn't know how long the window's going to be open and all that. And Harry just sat there, and he nodded, and he read the letter, and then he basically just kind of left and didn't talk to Doyle for the longest time. Or whenever he did, it would be very brief and just polite and just kind of cold. When Doyle finally got fed up with it and confronted Harry and said, "What's going on?" Harry came out to him and said, "The letter your wife wrote, it's been bothering me because she wrote it in English, and my mother could not speak or write a word of English her entire life. So I have trouble believing that she would somehow learn that ability on the other side. I feel like it would have been more credible if it had been in her own tongue." Because I think Harry's mother spoke German. Doyle tries to make this whole story about, like, oh, well, when you're in heaven, you learn all the skills you want to learn. So she probably picked it up when she was over there. And Harry Dean's like, yeah. And then it just, the friendship was never quite the same after that. Because I think Houdini always took it personally that he got suckered. Or at least that's what he felt like. He felt like he got suckered by one of his closest friends at the time. That rift stayed there pretty much until Houdini's death. The weird thing they talk about in this book is apparently shortly before Houdini's death, I think it was Marjorie Crandon, this witch of Lime Street, she came out and said that she was getting a message that Harry Houdini was going to die soon. She said that she was getting a message that said, I forget the exact message, but there was one line in there that said that Harry is doomed, doomed, doomed. Doyle heard about it, but he didn't come forward with it. He didn't mention it until Houdini had passed. After his death, Doyle tried to contact Bess, Harry's wife or widow, and he told her he knew about what the medium had said, but he said, "I didn't come forward to Harry because I didn't think he would hear me out. I didn't think he would take it seriously, so I didn't think there was much point." Bess did her best to kind of close that rift because she was like, "He's gone now. Don't beat yourself up over it. What are we going to do about it now?" She tried to make peace the best she could with the situation the way it was. But yeah, I thought that was kind of eerie. The other thing I thought was eerie with this is it's not really like pointed out in the book, but one thing I noticed reading, I started writing it down and I realized that of the people that were involved in the Scientific America contest, just sort of a spooky little connection to all this, if I have the dates right according to this book, Harry Houdini died on Halloween, 1926. J. Malcolm Bird, another guy on the panel, he died the day before Halloween in 1964. Crandon, Marjorie Crandon, the witch of Lime Street, she died the day after Halloween in 1941. If you're wondering about Doyle, he didn't die on Halloween. He died on July 7th, 1930. Yeah, there's a lot of interesting history, a lot of eerie history. There's a picture there, a picture of the newspaper clipping. This is Marjorie Crandon. This is Houdini near the time of his death. And the caption on the photo said, Harry Houdini, magician and exposer of fake mediums, was skeptical that the curse of death called down on his head by Marjorie would be effective. There's a lot of, like, neat, eerie history to this whole time period that I didn't know about that I really enjoyed in this book. You do have to be patient with it, though. There are some dry patches. But yeah, if you're a big history fan, if you like that era of World War One and paranormal and stuff, I would recommend at least giving this one read through. And there's also a couple other things I picked up on in this book. There was that, again, it's not like pointed out, it's just things that I mentally noticed. There was a part in here that said, the Society of American Magicians, of which Houdini was president, considered itself a voice of reason in this renaissance of medieval superstition. The society threatened to ostracize any magician who claimed to possess real supernatural powers. Modern magic was the natural enemy of spiritualism and the occult. Now, for anyone that's read Doctor Strange and Mr. Norrell, does that not sound like the society that started at the beginning of that book that said that, oh, we're not real magicians, we just like the history of it. You can't really do magic. That's just what that reminded me of. The other thing I thought was interesting was there's a section here that mentions when Arthur Conan Doyle was doing a tour in North America. And it said, during his American tour, he had noticed that the U.S. papers were full of alleged change of climate, encroachments of ice, and general signs of a glacial epoch. Disciples of Doom were on every soapbox. Popular books like Wither Mankind called the calamity unavoidable. That little blurb I thought was interesting because I think at this point, at that section in the book, I think they're talking about 1925, and I was just thought, it's interesting that in 1925, even, they were talking about climate change and global warming and, damage to the ice caps and all of that. Had nothing to do with any of this spiritual movement stuff, but I just thought that was an interesting blurb. So after I read that book, I was really curious to know things either from Doyle's or Houdini's side. I looked around and it turns out Houdini actually wrote like seven or eight different books in his lifetime on the topics of magic and spiritualism and, outing mediums and all of that kind of stuff. They're a little bit tricky to track down, though. I was able to find one that wasn't horrendously expensive and was in decent shape. So one of his books I picked up was Houdini, A Magician Among the Spirits. And this is his memoir he did after he carried out his own project. I think it was after all of this stuff with Scientific America went down. This was originally written in 1924, so this came out 2 years before he died. A lot of this book covers pretty much like all of the information he had garnered over like 30 years of studying, but he focuses in on this project he gave himself in the year of 1919, where he's spent that entire year studying, I think it was like over 100 mediums, it would involve mediums, but he attended over 100 seances and took notes, was again just searching for anybody that could give him irrefutable proof that the afterlife existed and that these people had the actual ability to talk to past loved ones. And he admits, he says right at the beginning of the book, I believe in God, I believe in the afterlife. I did not meet one person in any of those seances that could give me the proof I was looking for. And he says that right off the bat and then goes on for nearly 300 pages, I think, explaining why he came to that conclusion. The cool thing about this book is interspersed with all the stories are artifacts. Well, we would call them artifacts now, I guess. But there are pictures of different tools he would see the mediums using. And he also includes diagrams, which explain the different paranormal tricks that they would use, like with spirit writing and spirit knocking, making the sounds, making things move. He includes these diagrams. Like there's that one. There's, I tagged another one in here. Like this one, he shows how to use like a person's shoe to create an effect, which I thought was really cool that you get that in there. And he breaks it down for you and says, look, this is how a performer would pull this off. And he said, this is why I have a hard time believing it, because I can tell you exactly how they would do it. Like there's even one picture in here, like there's this picture in here of him working with this guy, Mr. Teal. I forget the guy's first name, but he's what he but this Teal guy called himself a spiritual photographer, who claimed he could catch orbs and spirit figures and things like that on camera. And he was one of the forerunners in that department during that time. But this is a photo of Houdini and his wife Bess there working with the photographer. And that's another thing he talks about in this book, is he went to all of the big names that people were going to, not just mediums. He went to these people that were photographers and paranormal investigators of the day, and he interviewed them. And just at the time, he could debunk a lot of what he was hearing. Oh, sorry, that was a different guy, that one I showed. I think this Teal guy was actually an assistant for them, but this was a photo of explaining that he and Bess would go and explain to people how they could recreate all these things that they thought were paranormal with other mediums. This is the psychic photographer guy. This elderly looking guy here, this is Alexander Martin. That shows Houdini talking to him and getting his stance on things. Again, this is a really cool history book if you just want, you know, that sort of like from the horse's mouth perspective. He goes over, he doesn't get a lot into this period, but he goes over it a little bit. One of the things that is good about this is he does go into more detail about what happened between him and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. The problem is, the feeling I got when I was reading this is, it was nice to hear his side, but then I also felt like you're hearing his side, so it's kind of like when you, it felt like, you know, when you're the friend stuck in the middle of a fight between two other friends, and you go to one friend and they tell you like the glossed over version of that makes them look good, and then you go to the other friend and they tell you the glossed over version that makes them look like the hero or the nice one. That's kind of what I felt like. I felt like it was good to hear his side of things, but I also felt like it, right now it feels a little bit unbalanced because I haven't read anything of Doyle's on the subject. So of course Houdini would have written himself in a good light and would have placed a lot of the weight on Doyle's opinions as far as like what tore them apart. So right now I still feel a little bit unbalanced about what I now know about that relationship. But even so, I think it is really interesting as a history book for just paranormal science and learning the whole community and environment behind spirit mediums. Because I'm kind of like Houdini. I like to think that there are people out there who do have that ability, but I also think that 99% of the people who claim they do don't actually. They're just taking advantage of people. But I was also reading this feeling like there is a lot of technology in paranormal science now that wasn't available to Houdini. And I feel like if Houdini was around now, he possibly could change his stance on things. You know, if he had things during his lifetime, such as EMF detectors or spirit boxes or heck, even, you know, digital recorders to catch EVPs, any of that stuff. None of that was available to him. All he had was these people that were doing things that were easily disprovable. And so, of course, he's going to write a book that says, I couldn't find anything, because he's going off of what he had available as far as ways to test it in his lifetime. But some of the things I found especially interesting in this was in one part of this book, they talk about how Robert Browning and his wife, Elizabeth Barrett Browning, got caught up in the spiritual movement, Elizabeth Barrett Browning especially. And there was a thing in here that said, it says, on one occasion, Robert Browning, the poet, attended one of Holmes' seances. He had become somewhat alarmed by his wife's interest in spiritualism, and when a face was materialized and said to be that of a son who had died in infancy, Browning seized the supposed materialized head and discovered it to be the bare foot of Mr. Holmes. Incidentally, Browning had never lost an infant son. The living son, Robert Barrett Browning, in a letter to the London Times on December 5, 1902, referring to this occurrence, said, Home was detected in a vulgar fraud. In the same letter, he tells of the modification of his mother's belief after having been deceived by a trusted friend, and his closing words were, the pain of the disillusion was great, but her eyes were opened and she saw clearly. So, yeah, that just... Again, it kind of goes back to why Houdini was compelled to do this. Is it wasn't that he was trying to be a dick and just make things bad for people. He was honestly offended that there were a lot of honest, hardworking people with very legit pain that were being taken advantage of, and that irked him. This was one of the things I thought was kind of funny. That picture I showed you of him working with the psychic photographer Alexander Martin, this is one of the examples Houdini shares of him showing how he can recreate what a lot of the psychics were passing off as paranormal. Kind of like, you know that kind of now famous photo of Mary Todd Lincoln where there's that image of Abraham Lincoln hanging over her, and now we know that it's very much superimposed and everything. It's kind of like this. But one thing that cracked me up was, if you look closely at this photo, like, they just put a bunch of these heads in here, but that's Teddy Roosevelt hanging over Houdini's head. I'm not quite sure about these other, it's kind of blurry, it's hard to tell, but that is definitely Teddy Roosevelt. So I just thought that was pretty funny that he's like, see, it's clearly not that hard to fake. One of the things that cracked me up when Houdini was explaining his stance was later on in the book, he talks about this idea he has called malobservation, where he says, when he says that people are sort of tricked into believing these things they're seeing, he said, it's not that I think people are stupid in any way, or, you know, how could they be so gullible? He said, it's what he calls malobservation, which is basically, he believes you believe what you're seeing. He believes that you believe that the thing in front of you is actually happening, because you don't have enough information available to you to know that things behind the curtain are being done to give you that image. So to explain that a little bit better, he has this one section in here. In Harry Houdini's words, he says, malobservation is responsible for a lot of misunderstanding, consequently misrepresentation, and as a result, much investigation is rendered valueless. Such misrepresentation is not intended to deceive, but is an honest expression of a conviction based on supposed facts by persons unaware that they are victims of illusion. One of the most, if not the most, flagrant instances of malobservation I have ever known is told in a book by J. Hewitt Mackenzie, president of the British College of Science, entitled Spirit Intercourse. On page 107, he says, Houdini, called the Handcuff King, who so ably demonstrated his powers upon public hall platforms is enabled by psychic power, though this he does not advertise, to open lock, handcuff, or bolt that is submitted to him. He has been imprisoned within heavily barred cells, doubly and trebly locked, and from them all he has escaped with ease. This ability to unbolt locked doors is undoubtedly due to his mediumistic powers, and not to any normal mechanical operation of the lock. The force necessary to shoot a bolt within a lock is drawn from Houdini the medium, but it must not be thought that this is the only means by which he can escape from his prison, for at times his body has been dematerialized and withdrawn, but this will be treated in another part of this chapter. So this guy actually wrote a book where he was saying that Houdini had the power to dematerialize himself to escape the cells and things he was locking himself into. This guy was presenting that as fact, to which Houdini goes on to respond to, "As I am the one most deeply concerned in this charge, I am also the best equipped to deny such erroneous statements. I do claim to free myself from the restraint of fetters and confinement, but positively state that I accomplish my purpose purely by physical and not psychical means. The force necessary to shoot a bolt within a lock is drawn from Houdini, the living human being, and not a medium. My methods are perfectly natural, resting on natural laws of physics. I do not dematerialize or materialize anything. I simply control and manipulate material things in a manner perfectly well understood by myself and thoroughly accountable for and equally understandable, if not duplicable, by any person to whom I may elect to divulge my secrets. But I hope to carry these secrets to the grave, as they are of no material benefit to mankind, and if they should be used by dishonest persons, they might become a serious detriment." And then Houdini says, "On page 112 of his book, Mr. McKenzie again refers to me, saying, 'Houdini of worldwide fame, previously mentioned, has for years demonstrated dematerialization and the passage of matter through matter upon the public platform, while Mrs. Thompson of America has demonstrated materialization. Mrs. Zanzig has, with her husband, publicly exhibited her psychic gift called thought transference, which is pure soul projection, in all the leading world centers. Miss Faye and several well-known Japanese mediums for years demonstrated the passage of matter through matter and also materialization. These are only a few of the many who might be mentioned who demonstrate psychic gifts before the public. Such public mediums do not, of course, advertise themselves as performing their wonder by occult powers or through the help of spirits, and the public are therefore left in ignorance on how they perform their marvelous tricks, as they are called. The author has tested each of these mentioned by a personal experiment from the stage, and several also in private, and can testify that they are mediums performing most, if not all, of their great wonders by spirit agency. They are naturally reluctant to acknowledge the fact, for the music hall public would instantly resent any claims they might make that they performed their wonders by spirit power. Their audiences would regard such claims as bunkum and probably subject them to insult, if not ill treatment, for the general public are entirely ignorant of such possibilities in the manipulation of psychical matter, as related in this book, which a medium can develop with the cooperation of spirit entities. It can be left to the reader's imagination to picture the face of a music hall manager if he were asked to allow upon the stage a demonstration of psychic powers. The poor man would not be able to sleep for nights if he thought ghosts were working around his buildings or upon his stage. Thus, knowing the attitude of men toward such things, these wonders of wonders are produced upon the music hall stage as clever mystery tricks. The author does not wish his readers to suppose that the mechanical sleight of hand tricks carried out by Maseklin and Devant and similar operators have anything to do with the mediumistic gift, for they are a mechanical copy of true magic. These tricks are performed with a ton of machinery, whereas the genuine medium can produce his wonders, if necessary, naked and in an empty room. The last occasion on which the author, under strict test conditions, saw Houdini demonstrate his powers of dematerialization was before thousands upon the public stage of the Grand Theatre, Islington, London. Here, a small iron tank filled with water was deposited upon the stage, and in it, Houdini was placed, the water completely covering his body. Over this, placed an iron lid with three hasps and staples, and these were securely locked. The body was then completely dematerialized within this tank within 1.5 minutes, while the author stood immediately over it. Without disturbing any of the locks, Houdini was transferred from the tank directly to the back of the stage in a dematerialized state. He was there materialized and returned to the stage front, dripping with water and attired in the blue jersey suit in which he had entered in the tank. From the time he entered it to his appearance on the stage, only 1.5 minutes had expired. While the author stood adjacent to the tank during the dematerialization process, a great loss of physical energy was felt by him, such as usually experienced by sitters in materializing seances, who have a good stock of vital energy, as in such phenomena, a large amount of energy is required. While in this state, Houdini was transferred from the stage to the retiring room behind, and there almost instantaneously materialized. The speed in which this dematerialization was performed is much more rapid than is possible in the materialization seance room, where time is required for the essence to be crystallized into psychoplastic matter. The fuck is this guy talking about? Not only was Houdini's body dematerialized, but it also carried through the locked iron tank, thus demonstrating the passage of matter through matter. This startling manifestation of one of nature's profoundest miracles is probably regarded by most of the audience as a very clever trick. If you manage to get through all that, then Houdini responds and says, "With the indulgence of the reader, I may be pardoned, perhaps, if I insist that it is just what I claim it to be. Simply a superior trick. The effect is original with me and was invented in the course of my professional career as a public entertainer for the sole purpose of entertaining audiences by mystifying them. My success seems to be attested by Mr. Mackenzie in his acknowledgement that he was deceived into the belief as to my mediumistic powers, that I dematerialized my body and material substance and materialized these things, so restoring them to a normal condition. In rebuttal to this misconception, I can only say that it is a demonstration of malobservation. There is nothing supernatural in my performance. If I really possessed such abnormal powers as Mr. Mackenzie credits me with, I should be only too ready to prove it for the enlightenment of a waiting world. I disagree with Mr. Mackenzie that such acknowledgement would displease the music hall or theater managers. On the contrary, I'm sure they would gladly open their stages for the demonstration and regard it as a good management and showmanship. As to the performance of Mrs. Thompson of America and Miss Fay, their work is no more psychic than mine. It is simply another phase of magical deception, and I stand ready to reproduce such performances in an emergency. Regarding the personally conducted tests of my work by Mr. Mackenzie, he did no more or less than all my other committees are privileged to do while on the stage during my acts. Just as all spiritualist believers do, so Mr. Mackenzie relied on what he thought he saw, and therefore failed to affirm or negative his misguided and misdirected vision by rational application of his conscious intelligence. Had he brought his reasoning faculties to bear, as all sincere, unbiased investigators should, he would have discovered the utter inconsistency of his deductions and never have gone on record as the author of such folly without a particle of real evidence to which to substantiate his claim. I liked this for the fact that it gave good background to this book, and it gave me a good deal of respect for Houdini, even though from Houdini's work it was a little bit comical to me to read his book, because I felt like, shit, this guy had an ego. He's like, he comes off as a cocky bastard in parts of the book, his own book. But, you know, when you think about his career, he kind of had a right to be, you know. It's like Muhammad Ali said, it's not bragging if you can back it up. but it was kind of funny to read it, though. To see, like, you know, he's like, yeah, I did that. But I also had a respect for him for saying that a lot of what you think is mystery can be explained, but he liked to think that there were things out there that he couldn't explain. He was obsessive about collecting books on magic and the paranormal and the occult because he wanted to learn. He wanted to educate himself. So it wasn't just Houdini going out and saying, these people are full of shit and how dare you believe them. It was, he wanted to prove it to himself and he wanted to prove it to other people. And he was always open for anybody to come back and prove him wrong if he came out and said something. But in his lifetime, he said, I didn't really run into people who would disprove what I was learning for myself. But again, I was left with that feeling of, I wish there was a way we could bring him back and have him experience the way paranormal science is now. If nothing else, I think he would just be fascinated with the technology that's out there now. So that was it for Houdini and the whole spiritualist movement, spiritualism. I just wanted to do this nonfiction starter for the video. This wasn't meant to be like a bio on Houdini. I don't know, that may come down the road at some point, but I just wanted to focus on Houdini and his involvement in the spiritualist movement for this nonfiction bit. And then in the upcoming videos for this series, I will come back with fiction that is inspired by his life or people in his life. So this one's probably going to be kind of a long one, but I thought there was a lot of cool information in here to share. So hopefully you stuck around. If you did, thank you so much. Feel free to share your thoughts down below, and we'll see you in the next round. Thanks for watching, guys. See you soon.